Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure to see all of us here gathered again. For those of us who were here last week, it was a wonderful time. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We will read the call to worship responsively. God, the Creator, is in this place.
The love of God is with us.
Jesus, our Redeemer, is in this place.
The grace of our Lord is with us.
The Holy Spirit is in this place.
God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, be with us now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, we thank you for the blessings of last week and for the joy of entering a new week with you. Thank you for the opportunities to serve that will be ours. And thank you for the blessings that we will have. We know that difficulties will come our way, but we have the assurance from your word that you will be with us always, in all situations. We come this morning with everything, with our triumphs and our defeats, with our grief and with our joy, with our setbacks and our victories. And we know that whatever you send us is good. We lay our sins before you this morning, our waywardness, our act of disobedience, and ask for your forgiveness. So cleanse us of all our sins and put within us the desire to serve you faithfully, unwaveringly. Serve you with everything in us, with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. We commit this service to you, O Lord, and ask that you would lead and guide. And anything contrary to your spirit, the leading of your spirit will be tossed out, will be cast out, will be dismissed by you. May we turn our eyes upon you. May we turn our ears to you, so we can see you with eyes of faith and hear you speaking to us in no uncertain terms. Guide us, O Lord, and we will follow. We ask these mercies in the name of Jesus. Amen. His name is wonderful. Jesus our Lord. Lord God, every now and then we need reminders. We need reminders of who you are. We stand in captivating awe of an omniscient, omnipresent, and omnipotent God, whose eye is on us as on the sparrow. And I know in the words of the songwriter, he watches us. Thank you, Lord, for watching over us. Thank you for deliverance. Thank you for healing. Thank you for your protection. Thank you for your provision. Pray that you will strengthen our faith and wisdom to seek your grace and mercy. We come to you this morning with our brokenness. We come to you with our disappointments. We come with our regrets. We come with our pain. We come with sorrows. And we ask you to mend our hearts, torn apart by the unkindness of this world. We ask that you heal our souls, wasting away from the despair all around us. We ask you to forgive our sins, those that we allow to persist, especially those that we would regard as small sins. Forgive them. We pray for the reconciliation of the world, whose division condemns us. We pray for the courage to admit our fault in the messiness of this world. And we pray for strength to amend our actions and the hope that your grace awaits us. Oh God, we come this morning believing in your power to heal and to deliver. Hear us on behalf of our brother James Evans, Linda Hickman Evans, and family. For Jenny, for Patricia, and family. For Val, her brother Terry, and her daughter Kelly. For Christette, Mary Bailey. For Joyce, flower. The harpers, Connie, for Leonard Vi, for Loretta and Josina. Lord, the list goes on and on. Their circumstances may be different, but Lord, you understand their need. Some need healing. Healing of their sickness and disease. Some need a helping hand with their finances. Resources that would come handily that you have to offer. Some need hope for a better tomorrow. Some need forgiveness of sin. Some need courage to face the challenges of today and tomorrow. Lord, hear our prayers this morning. I commit to you, everyone, this morning, your giving God. We surrender ourselves to you, and you do what you will for us. We ask these mercies in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm reading out the Good News Bible, and the scripture reading is Isaiah 5, verse 20, and Romans 8, verse 32 to 37. You are doomed. You call evil good and call good evil. You turn darkness into light and light into darkness. You make what is bitter sweet, and what is sweet you make bitter. Okay. Certainly not God, who did not even keep back his own son, but offered him for all. He gave his son, will he not also freely give us all things? Who will accuse God's chosen people? God himself declares not guilty. Who then will condemn them? Not Christ Jesus, who died, or rather who was raised to live, to life. It is at the right side of God, pleading with him for us. Who then can separate us from the Lord of Christ? Can trouble do it, or hardship, or persecution, or hunger, or poverty, or danger, or death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are in danger of death at all times. We are treated like sheep that are going to be slaughtered. Now, in all these things, we have complete victory through him who loved us. For I am certain that nothing can separate us from love, neither death, neither life, nor angels, nor other heavenly rules of power, neither the present nor the future, neither the world above nor the world below. There is nothing in all creation that will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is ours through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Just a verse of the lessons that were read by Gretchen, just a verse for emphasis. And it's Romans 8, verse 37. Know in all these things we have complete victory through him who loved us. Last week I preached on the theme of the celebration, Reigniting a Nation for Greatness. But the sub-theme was Walking in Victory. And today I want to continue that victory theme. So we're talking about victorious living. Let us pray. Have thine own way, O Lord. Speak to us through your word. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Romans 6, verses 12 and 13. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. And so I begin with the question. Do you consider your life to be a victorious one? You have to do the assessment. Is your life as you live it a victorious one? You see, it can be easy to walk through life feeling defeated. And it can seem hard to figure out exactly how to live a life of victory. There are many people who would want us to believe that they see their life as being victorious. But they don't think it is. They think about their defeats, their failures. You see, the struggles of life on earth will remain for all generations. Sin, fear, doubt, brokenness, and death are not going away. However, Jesus promise life, not just life, abundant life. And the abundant life includes victory. It includes triumph. It includes pursuit. It includes triumph over sin, over fear, over doubt, over brokenness, and even death. He promised life to the full. I am come that you might have life and have it in all its fullness. John 10 verse 10 is one of those verses. There are no three easy steps. You know, if you get a cookbook or any book to work in the lawn, in the garden, to bake, there are some three easy steps to accomplish the task. But there are no three easy steps to an easy Christian life, because there is no such thing as easy Christian life. This morning I was listening to one of my brother pastors back home preaching. And he says that, you know, as pastors we have the privilege of walking alongside people going through difficulties. And even in time of death, we have the privilege of walking alongside survivors who grieve. But we aren't exempt from those experiences. We go through them too. So there are no three easy steps for the pastor. But there are solutions to the problems that keep us from living a victorious Christian life. Allow me to share three with you quickly. The first is that part of living the victorious Christian life is properly dealing with temptation. And I'm not saying just dealing with temptation, but properly dealing with temptation. You see, the war between good and evil was not over after what I call Satan's defeat in the pre-mortal life. Revelation 12 verse 17 tells us that Satan continues to war against the saints of God. And when you read the book of Revelation, as we have done in the past couple of months, he has really put up a fight and will continue until God locks him away properly. Right, Kathy? Yes. Kathy's very concerned about the devil being locked away permanently.
Amen.
Amen. Right. So up to that point, and it's going to be a long time from now, I believe. Even Jesus should come tomorrow, it's going to be a good while before Satan is locked away properly and being punished for all his wrongdoing. You see, the devil doesn't want us possessing our possession in Christ. But he's already defeated. He has already lost the battle, and he knows that. This means that we don't have to fight sin. Our fight is a fight of faith. Our fight is to keep on believing, is to believe and to continue to believe in Jesus. To believe is not an act of the past. Oh, I once believed. No, you believe and you continue to believe, and every day you believe that Satan has already lost the battle and you can be victorious in Jesus. And part of our warfare is to realize, yes, that the devil is not equal to God. The devil is not the opposite of God. He cannot be compared to God. God has no equal. So for us to properly deal with our temptations, we have to know from whom we get our strength and understand the power of God in Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 13 says, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. All of us have been tempted. I'm not spared. I have my temptations. And the way I overcome them is the way you overcome them. There's no difference for me. There's no different path for the pastor. And some people, oh, the pastor has it easy. No, he doesn't. Or she doesn't. It's the same. I was looking at some news. I was reading where abuse, a lot of members within the Southern Baptist Church, the convention, are abused by pastors, by deacons, by missionaries. And now the government is involved. So that some of these people may end up in jail, and they should. We are all equal before the law, aren't we? Every one of us. Let's pray for one another. Because my temptations are not yours, necessarily. And yours aren't mine. We should pray one for another. And in your off temptation, you will find strength. To be tempted is not sin. It's to yield. The second thing I want to point out about victorious living is that victorious living is overcoming. It's about overcoming. It's not to avoid. We don't avoid the problems of life. And it seems that when you become a Christian, that's the time you really get into fire. That's the time you are really tested. So victorious living is overcoming trials. It is overcoming the effects of failure. And who? Is there anybody inside who has never failed in anything? We used to sing a song about, oh, He never fails me, yet he never fails me. Yes, Jesus never fails me yet. I want the world to know he never fails me yet. But we can't sing that about ourselves. We have all failed. That's why back home again we have this song, if at first you don't succeed, try. try again. Right? But we have all failed at things. Victorious living is overcoming setbacks. Violin wanted to go somewhere this weekend and they're here. They told me they would not be here. And I believed them. Right? And this morning, the first four eyes I saw were of eyes and limbs. They had a setback. But it's for the better. We're glad it never happened, that it did not happen while you're away. What are all the kind of setbacks? Sickness can be a setback.
He gave me a wise husband.
Yes.
Amen.
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 From the day, first day I met him, he was a wise guy. All right. And Val, I know you deserve a wise man.
He needs
that. And overcome tribulation. But you inside, you have no idea when I talk about tribulation, what that is. No. You know what tribulation is. It's to overcome. Victorious living is conquering your fears. Everybody has fears. One of my fears is height. I don't do well with height. But I sit in the plane at the window, and you know I'm quite a few miles above ground. That doesn't bother me. But let me just say, I don't do well with height.
You don't
want to
claim this.
No. One year I was passing by here and John was about to go up the roof and I stopped and I came out and I gave him something and he just walked up the ladder like he was just on ground, you know. And he went up and he was walking on the roof and I said, well, I couldn't make a living from that. That's just not me.
That's why you gotta be a pastor.
That's why I'm a pastor. I stay in the pulpit. Victorious living is knowing God's peace. Victorious living is persevering through the troubles, our hardships, our persecution, our famine, our nakedness, our danger, our sword. Paul says, not even these can separate us from the love of God, or should separate us. Showing us that we can be more than conquerors through him who loved us. And the third and final is that victorious Christian life is the life that is lived. It's a lived experience. It's a phenomenon. It's lived. It's not something we earn. It's living by faith in a moment by moment surrender to God. It's not something you did yesterday. But it's something you did this morning and it's something you will do this afternoon. Moment by moment, by moment. The victorious Christian life is rooted and grounded in faith. And the Bible assures us that God and his son Jesus Christ are victors, and that the believers can share in their victories. When last have you had a victory that you can tell the world about? Somebody is writing a book and asked me to write a chapter about victories in my life. And I said, yeah, I'm glad to do that. And a couple of days I was thinking about it, and I asked myself, what am I going to write about? You see the challenges that come to us? But by God's grace, I'm going to write that chapter. We did doctoral work together. And she wants her classmates to write some of those chapters about victories in your personal life. She wants stories from no other than from the person she has asked to write it. And Paul says, but thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through Jesus Christ. That victory according to our own strength, because by ourselves we are failures. But combined with the power of God and God's knowledge and yours, you can tell stories about your victories. And I hope you'll tell your own story to your children and to your children's children about your victories. You see, the victory that I'm talking about is not our victory. That we won by ourselves. It is not our responsibility to give us victory. Jesus has promised that. But the obedience and submission to the Lordship of Christ is what we must attend to in our own lives. Submission and obedience to the Lordship of Christ. It is our responsibility to surrender and trust in the victory of Jesus, because that is enough to provide freedom and victory for all. So then, if you consider yourself to be weak and frail and tired and insignificant, tell yourself this morning that you are a confident person. You're a confident servant of Jesus. Tell yourself that. Use the personal pronoun. I am confident in Christ. I am capable in Christ. I love challenge in Christ, because nothing shall separate me from the love of God in Jesus Christ. And then I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Right, Anne? I know that's your favorite passage.
Philippians 4:13.
Amen. I can hear the words of the song in my spirit. By the hand of the Almighty, I have been set free.
Amen.
Hallelujah. By the hand of the Almighty, I'm healed from my sickness. I'm healed from my disease. I'm healed from my surgery. I'm healed from that which got me down in despair for years. From God, I'm healed. By the hand of God, I've been delivered. By the hand of God, I've been made complete in Him. I know I'm walking in victory. Victory in walking, I got back all that I've lost. Walking in victory, I've got back my peace. Some people have lost their peace and they wonder how they're going to get back their peace. Peace, perfect peace in this dark world of sin. Yes! Jesus whispers peace to those who listen. Walking in victory, I got back my joy. Some people have lost their joy. Jesus says, you can have it back. Walking in victory, some people will say, I've got back my hope. I was living in despair. I had no trust in anyone, not even God. But one day I woke up and I could trust again. Yeah. Some people say, I'll never get married again. Woo! And one day, one morning, God opened his hand. I'll marry again.
The wonders of God.
Yeah! I've got back my spark. Amen. Or somebody say, I got my groove back. Mm-hmm. I can love again. Amen? Amen. Whatever is victory for you this morning, praise God. I have my victories. I have many. Failures there are, yes. But my victories outnumber my failures in Jesus. Therefore, you can say, I have a story to tell to the nation. A story of love, a story of victory. And when you tell it, you say, this is my story and this is my song. And because of that, I'm praising my Savior. Hallelujah. And the church of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. Let us pray. God of all ages, who from generation to generation has heard the cries of your children, hear the thoughts of our hearts. Examine our motives, forgive our faults, forgive our sinful words and actions. Forgive us when we fail to live lives that reflect your love. Forgive us the many times we have taken for granted all that you have done for us to give us victory. Transform us through your Spirit and empower us to serve you this day and always through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Jesus, the Master, the Savior.
bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.